Group 17's chemical reaction with oxygen and hydrogen we just now saw. After that, we have got to see how do they react with halogens. Now, very important, that is halogens itself combined with another halogens to form n numbers of interhalogen compounds. Okay, these interhalogen compounds can be of various types, that is XX dash, XX3 dash, XX5 dash and XX7 dash. Means it can combine to form monohalide, trihalide, pentahalide and heptahalides. Now in this session we are going to see the types, their formulas, their states and very important is their structure, because many a times this question is asked in boards as well as in MCQs with respect to the interhalogen compounds. Now the different types of interhalogen compounds, first we have XX dash. Now in this it can combine to form chlorofluoride, bromofluoride, bromochloride, iodochloride, iodobromide. Okay, once again I repeat, with fluorine it can be chlorine bromine, with chlorines it will be bromine iodine and with bromine it will be iodine. Okay, so in there among them chlorofluoride is your colorless gas having a geometry linear. Bromofluoride is pale brown gas having a geometry again linear. Bromochloride is a gas which is having a geometry linear. Iodochloride has got two allotropes. We name it as alpha and beta. Its alpha form is a ruby red color solid, whereas beta form is a brown red color solid, and they both have a same geometry linear. Then we have iodobromide, which is a black color solid, and of course its geometry is again linear. Okay, now in this many a times they can ask us the geometry of the molecule or the color of the molecule, or sometimes they can ask which all monohalides can be formed, so we need to remember this. Then the next one we have, that is trihalides. Now trihalides are generally fluorides which is formed by the remaining three halogens, chlorofluoride, bromofluoride or chlorotrifluoride, bromotrifluoride and iodotrifluoride. Chlorotrifluoride is a colorless gas having a bent T shape. Bent T shape, if you remember, we have done this in chemical bonding part. Okay, so please again you can refer to that. We have already done this. Bromotrifluoride is a yellow green color liquid, again has a geometry of bent T shape. Iodotrifluoride is a yellow color powder having a same geometry or same structure. After trihalides, the next we have pentahalides. Now in pentahalides again they can be all pentafluorides with chlorine, bromine and iodine. Chlorine pentafluoride is a colorless liquid having a square pyramidal geometry. Bromine pentafluoride is again a colorless liquid having the same square pyramidal geometry. Iodopentafluoride is a colorless gas, but it is solid below 77 Kelvin temperature, and again it also shows the same geometry, that is square pyramidal. After pentafluoride, the next one we have heptafluoride. Now in heptafluoride there is only one possibility, that is iodine heptafluoride. There is no other heptafluoride forms. Heptafluoride, iodoheptafluoride, is a colorless gas and it has a geometry which is pentagonal bipyramidal. Okay, now this difference in geometry is everywhere because of the presence of lone pair of electron. So chemical bonding under the heading of VSEPR, that is valence shell electron pair repulsion theory, we have already discussed all these things in detail. So you can refer that so as to observe the geometry of this interhalogen compounds. After the properties of group 16, 17, the next we have group 18. Now among the whole periodic table, group 18 elements are least reactive. The reasons for them, first they have a completely filled NS2NP6 electronic configuration in their valence shell except for helium, means their octet is complete. Second, they have high ionization enthalpy and their electron gain enthalpy is a very high positive values. So generally Due to these reasons, they are chemically inert, and as they are chemically inert, we do not have many of the compounds having the group 18 elements. After doing the chemical properties of group 16, 17, 18, the next thing we have to see is some of the compounds containing the elements of group 16, 17 and 18. There the first one we have oxoacids of sulfur. Now the first and foremost question comes is, what is meant by oxoacids? Now oxoacids, as the name suggests, it is an acid containing oxygen. So when sulfur forms a number of compounds combining with oxygen, we call it as oxoacids. Some of them are unstable and cannot be isolated. They are known to exist in aqueous solution or in the form of their salts. Whereas some important oxoacids of sulfurs have been studied and their properties and structure is also been known. So we will just see them. The first one we have is the formula H2SO3. That is sulfurous acid. In this, its oxidation state of the sulfur atom is plus 4 and the structure of H2S2O3 is like this. Okay, now we have to by heart the structure, students. Reason behind, many a times a question is asked in this is how many SOH bond it has, or how many S double bond O it has, or how many lone pair of electrons are present in this given structure. Or sometimes they can only ask you simply explain the structure of oxoacids of sulfur. So in that we have to remember the structure. So in H2SO3, the central sulfur atom has two OH bonds, one double bond O and one lone pair of electron. As it is attached to four bonds, its oxidation state in this case is plus 4. Then the next one we have a very commonly used acid, that is sulfuric acid, having a formula H2SO4. In this, the central sulfur atom has oxidation state plus 6, where the structure is again tetrahedral, but then the geometry, the bonds are little different. We have two OH bonds and two double bond O bonds. So in case this, you can check that the central sulfur atom is having total 6 bonds. And that is why its oxidation state comes to be plus 6. The third oxoacid of sulfur we have, that is peroxodisulfuric acid, having a formula H2S2O8. Now why we call it as disulfuric? Because if you can compare, SO4's double, that is S2O8. That is why we call it as disulfuric. Now peroxo, because in the structure you would see there is one O, single bond O. That is peroxo type of bonding. That is why we call it as peroxo disulfuric acid. In this, the structure is where sulfur individually has two double bond O and one single bond OH. And then they two are attached to each other by peroxy, means O single bond O. Again in this, each sulfur atom has total 6 bonds. That is why each sulfur atom oxidation state will be plus 6. The next oxoacid of sulfur is pyrosulfuric acid, also commonly called as oleum, having a formula H2S2O7. The structure in this, it does not have that peroxy part as compared to the above one. Remaining structure is almost the same. There it was H2S2O8. That's why there was two oxygens over here. It is O7, so only one O, and remaining part is same. Again, each sulfur atom is having 6 bonds. So its oxidation state, the sulfur atom's oxidation state is plus 6. The next one we have, that is peroxymonosulfuric acid. Now, sulfuric acid is H2SO4. We have one more oxygen. That is why we call it as peroxymonosulfuric acid. Now in this, the sulfur atom will have two double bond O, one single bond OH and one single bond OOH. And that is again, it will have peroxy type of bonding. Okay, again the central sulfur atom has total 6 bonds, so its oxidation state will be plus 6. Then the last oxoacids of sulfur we have, having a formula H2S2O3, that is thiosulfuric acid. In this, the bonding is little different. Here the two sulfurs are attached to each other with this double bond. the central sulfur has one double bond S, another double bond O, and then two single bond OH. So the central sulfur atom has got total 6 bonds, and that is why its oxidation state will be plus 6. Whereas the sulfur atom which is at the periphery, it has only double bond. So its oxidation state will be plus 2 in this case. Okay, so this is one very important structure where both the sulfurs oxidation states are different. So we need to remember the structure, their names, their formulas, and the oxidation state of sulfur atom in each oxo acid.